Welcome to the Hope Sports Podcast, where we chat each week with athletes about purpose. I'm your host, Olympic gold medalist Laura Wilkinson. And I'm so excited because today on our show, we have legendary speed skater Dan Jansen. For those of you who need a refresher or might be too young to remember, Dan dominated the sport of speed skating for nearly a decade. He competed in four Olympics and won gold after gold in the professional circuit. He shared with me that going into his final Olympics, the previous five world records in the 500 meters were all his. But despite his speed and international renown, the Olympic podium evaded him time after time. Dan shares about the disappointments and frustrations, the pressure of public perception, and the death of his sister on race day of his first games that changed his life and purpose. Such powerful stuff from such an amazing athlete. Thanks for joining me. Let's dive on in. Dan Jansen, the legend. Welcome to the Hope Sports Podcast. Thank you so much for being our guest today.
Thank you, Laura. Good to be here.
Okay, so for our listeners that somehow may not be familiar with you, can you please tell us how you kind of got started into sports and speed skating?
Well, I grew up in Wisconsin, so that helped to be near ice my whole life. But more so than that, I was youngest of nine kids. All eight of my brother and sister skated before I did. So when I was four, they just got me a pair of hand-me-down skates and took me to the ice rink, you know, and so I can't say it was really my choice at four. It was sort of just going along with the family. But certainly as I got older, definitely was my choice. I was pretty good in most of the sports I tried and played a lot of them, but then kind of gravitated toward speed skating. Yeah, in my mid-teens, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you were just a teenager at your very first Olympics in Sarajevo, right?
I was. Yeah, I was 18. And I say I still skated. I never stopped skating once I started, but as I said, I played other sports. But yeah, at 18, I made my first Olympic team. So that was, it was pretty good. And it was fun for me to have that success at an early age. And it really gave me a lot of confidence for, what would end up a pretty successful career.
Mm-hmm, I would say so. Well, at that first Olympics, I mean, you were super successful. You finished fourth in the 500 meters, just barely missing a bronze by like 1/16 of a second. I mean, what was that actual Olympic experience like for you? I mean, were you kind of too young to know what was going on, or did you know exactly what was happening? Like, take us through that.
Yeah, you know, a little of both. I think sometimes ignorance is a great thing because, you know, it happens a lot. Every Olympics I've ever been a part of, and I competed in four, and I called, five, six now. And so there's always surprises at the Olympics, and it's usually someone who's never been on a podium will win a medal. And it just happens that way because you're just so excited to be there. There's no pressure at all, no expectations. And that was sort of me in my first one. I was happy to be there. I made the team. I did win at our US trials. And so I was our top guy going in, but basically myself and another guy. But, I was hoping maybe a top 10, and I would have been more than satisfied. And then, I was sitting in third place there for a while until one guy edged me out. So it was exciting, but really the games themselves were the highlight that year for me, just being part of it, experiencing what the Olympics were and seeing and meeting other athletes from around the world. And, you've been there and that's just really a cool part of it. The opening ceremony, all of that stuff is for a first timer. You're just real wide eyed.
Oh yeah. Well, I know you said you were super stoked about your finish. Cause like you said, you were hoping for maybe a top 10 and you end up fourth, but when you came home, you said people kind of kept coming up to you and they were bummed that you missed the medals. Like, were you confused by that? Or did you get that? Like, what did that do to your headspace, I guess?
Yeah. It's a little confusing because, when you, as you're training, you kind of know maybe what your own expectations might be. And then you know, as I said, mine were exceeded, and then I came home, and then, you know, I did get a lot of reaction. That's too bad, and you know, sorry, you didn't win a medal, and yeah, of course, it would have been great to win a medal that first time, but for me, it was the games were a huge success. It was, as I said, sort of the beginning of my career, and so excited about it. And then to come home and find some people were disappointed it hurt a little bit. Of course, I get it. I understand. And I know with the media, it's really all about medals and medal count and all of that. But I think people don't realize that, you know, what is it? I would say close to probably 85-90% of the athletes at any games aren't going to come home with a medal. They, you know, and a big number don't expect to. They're happy to be there and compete. And so I was fortunate over my career to have, you know, all both sides of that spectrum, you know, from that and then being favored at my next three. But at least I that gave me a good bit of perspective. That first one,
I would imagine. Yeah, and like you said, over the next 4 years, you became very dominant. And heading into the 88 games in Calgary, you're now the favorite in both the 500 and the 1,000-meter races. Like, what was walking into that games? Like, how was that different from your first one where you were kind of this naive teenager?
Yeah, it's a lot different. You know, the going into the Olympics as a favorite is one of the hardest things that I think an athlete can do. And it's... you know, for me, 88 was a different animal all in itself because of the personal things we had going on with my sister's illness at the time, which we'll get to. But you know, now the awe of the games is not the same. It's not in a bad way. It's just that now you're sort of there to do business, and you know, you plan to, you know, be on that podium and possibly win gold. But, and so that's kind of where your preparation has led up to. And, it's a different feeling altogether going into the games. It's still fun. It's still exciting. And you really have to try to remember that and keep it there. But it is hard going in as a favorite. It really is.
Mm-hmm. Well, you mentioned your sister. So Jane, what was your relationship with her like?
So Jane was the youngest of my five sisters. She was still 5 years older than I, but there were the three youngest in the family, Jane and my brother Mike and myself. We were the ones who, you know, I'm not going to say we were the closest, but we were the youngest. And so we did a lot of things together. We did a lot of family trips and things like that when some of my older brother and sisters were already, you know, out of the house or, you know, a couple even married, that kind of thing. And so we were super close from, you know, forever. and she was kind of a friend. She was, you know, a mom-ish when she had to be, you know, to me, even though she was still young. She was there, always there, you know. She had this innate understanding, I would say, of what I felt, what I was thinking, and the good times, the bad times, all of that. And and then, you know, 1987, a year before those games, she just had her third little baby and still in the hospital, and then was diagnosed with leukemia just from routine blood tests. So from that point on, it was a fight. You know, she was getting treatment, bone marrow transplants, chemo, all of the things that you go through. And that was also the year that, you know, I was trying to train for the upcoming games.
Well, what condition was she in as you were heading to Calgary?
You know, that's the thing. So, I would say about 4 months before that, she went into remission. And so we were, you know, just so happy and so hopeful. And And then really about, I would say early January, end of December, early January, she came out of remission, and then and she wasn't doing real well. But I went, thank God, the World Championships had happened to be in Milwaukee, in my hometown, and where she lived as well, a week before the Olympics. And so I went and skated those, and I won. And so I was obviously going into Calgary feeling great, skating great, and very confident. But she wasn't doing great. I went to the hospital after the competition, basically to say goodbye, because we were heading up to Calgary the next morning. Mm-hmm. But when I say goodbye, I mean, you know, until March, till the season was over. And no one had a clue that she was going to be gone in a week. It was more, you know, she's going through a rough patch, but she'll fight through this. Mm-hmm. And so that's kind of how I left it, the situation, and I left her and then went up to Calgary and had a great week on the ice and was super. I mean, you know, when you're diving well and everything feels great and it's easy. And that's how it was for me. I was just
ready, right?
No one's going to touch me. And then literally the day before the race, my dad, was on the ice and he kind of pulled me over and he said, you know, Mom wants me at home, so I gotta go. Jane's not really doing well. So he flew home, and then 6 a.m. the next morning, the day of the race, is when I got the phone call. I was in the Olympic Village, and you know, as soon as the phone rang, or the I should say that as soon as somebody knocked on the door, it was just like I knew, you know. So I went down to the USOC office just shaking and shaking because I knew what was coming. And they said, you know, my mom's on the phone. She said, Jane's probably not going to make it through the day, and we just wanted to give you a chance to say goodbye. And that's how my race day started. And it was February. It was Valentine's Day, February 14th. I'll never forget. So
was she able to respond to you at all? Like, was she able to talk to you on the phone?
She was. So she could not speak, but some of those siblings that were there, my brother said she was, you know, motioning, and you know, so at least, of course, I don't know exactly, but at least it made me feel better that she could, she heard me. And not a way that you normally prepare for a competition, any competition, let alone the Olympics.
Yeah. And how did that affect you going into that race that day? I mean, how do you get your head on straight after that?
Well, I guess for me, I didn't. You know, I thought, so basically what I did was, you know, I went to, you know, half of my family was still there. About half my brothers and sisters, and half were back home. And so one of my brothers came into the village, and we just spent a couple hours, you know, at breakfast talking, and then actually confirmation did come that she had passed. And so
all before your race.
Yeah, and so, you know, I remember I literally go back into the room in the village and just laid on my bed, and my roommate and training partner, teammate, he was in there, and we were just bawling our eyes out. You know, he was part of the family as well, basically. And you know, and then now it's all of a sudden it's like 4 hours till race time. And so I said, all right, well, because I knew, so we were on the phone, we discussed this, should I skate, should I not, you know, should I just come home? And I was willing to do anything. I didn't know. It was a fight for me mentally, whether I should, you know, and it sounds weird, but think about, you know, I actually thought, well, what if I go out and skate and I win, and, you know, are people going to think I don't care, or, you know, just things that maybe, of course, it's now, you know, I know people, it doesn't matter really what people think. It's what you feel is right. But at that point, I'm 22 years old and
goes through your head,
you know, that's what was going through my head. Yeah. And so, anyway, the day itself was just trying, you know, went for a jog, trying to loosen up, get my mind and say, just let's give this a couple hours. There's nothing you can do now, with her situation, and go do what you do. And so I remember getting to the track and getting on the ice for warm up, and as good as I had felt literally 24 hours before, like so invincible, I step on the ice and I couldn't, like, my skate, like, it was like they weren't my feet. Like they were wobbly. There was no stability. I couldn't. And that's not a good feeling, you know, when you're going, you know, we go close to 40 miles an hour and you're on these blades that are 16th of an inch wide, you need stability. So it wasn't there. and I just thought, all right, well, give it a go. So then, you know, you get off the ice and then you get back on for your race. And I just hoped it would be better when I got back on the ice. And yeah, it was better, but it still wasn't good. Mm-hmm. And, 100 meters into the race, I knew I wasn't, even the first 100, I just didn't feel right. And so I figured, all right, I got to do something to make this time up that I felt like I lost in the first 100 meters, and literally one stroke into the turn and my left skate just slipped out from under me and I was down. It was not an ideal day.
Yeah, but you had another race just a couple of days later, the 1000. What did you even want to continue skating that? Did you think you'd be all right by that point?
Similar thing happened. It was more of a discussion with the family and coach and all that. But we kind of felt like, again, you know, my mom, my dad, they thought, look, because we all knew Jane was super sensitive. And if I would have, you know, not tried and just gone home, she would have felt terrible, like responsible and all. And so we thought, Jane would want you to go out and skate and give it a go. And so we thought, all right, so we got 3 days. And then at that point, at least the initial shock of all of it, you know, when it all happens in one day, it's really indescribable. And so by the third day, at least on the ice, I was feeling back to my normal self. I felt my legs. I felt, you know, it was, at least physically, I felt, I won't say completely normal, but I'll say, you know, I was good.
Yeah.
And, but mentally still was, you know, it was still kind of a battle. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, that at this point, everybody knows what happened, you know, 4 days ago. So there's that aspect of it. But, you know, I went and it was good. I was going great. And then just with just a half lap to go, 1,000 meters is 2.5 laps. And it just at the 95% of falls in speed skating happen on the turns, because we're going 40 and you got to turn left. And a lot of times, you know, the force wants to take you straight and you have to turn. And so, if there's a fall, it's almost always on the turn. And mine happened in the middle of the backstretch. I just caught an outer edge. Now, every skater knows what it's like to catch an outer edge, but it's very rare that it happens in a race. And I did. I just put my foot down and caught the outer edge. And I was down. And so that was it. And after that, I was like, okay, please, now I want to go home. I just need to go to say goodbye to Jane and be with the rest of the family. And, it wasn't even like, there's two Olympic medals I could have, and they're, that didn't happen. I never, that wasn't even a thought in my mind. I just wanted to get out of there, go home. I knew I was coming back. I had Bonnie Blair was racing, and I wanted to watch her and be there for her. But I also needed to be home for a few days and just and say our proper goodbyes. And so that's so we left that night and flew back home.
Yeah. Well, I love that you credit a lesson that your father imparted on you when you were younger. You gave this example that you said you were 12 years old and you were pretty sure you were going to win a national championships, but you finished second and you cried all the way home on the drive from Minneapolis to Milwaukee. And you kept thinking this great advice was going to come from your father to make you feel better. And when you got into the house, he said, "There's more to life than skating in little circles." And he left the room.
Yeah.
And you said it wasn't what you expected. Yeah, but it was your dad. So you believed him and you kept that in the back of your mind. And you said that helped you when your sister passed away and you felt the Olympics, that the words came back and you finally knew what that meant. Can you explain that a little bit to me?
Yeah. Yeah, it was exactly what you said. I'll never forget because he always had a way to make us feel better. He was a quiet guy. He didn't say a lot, but when things went wrong or if he needed to impart something, it meant a lot, you know? And so when he said that, I was kind of like, that's not what I want to hear. You know, there's more to life than skating around a circle. But yeah, then literally 10 years later, you know, with Jane's death and my falls, that lesson, those words came back to me and you know what, this is what he meant. You know, this skating it's a part of my life. It always will be, or as long as I decide to skate, but it's not my life. You know, it's not my whole life. There's a lot of other things. And so, you know, hard way to learn a lesson, but, you know, most of the time when we learn lessons, they are hard. They're not, you know, when things go great, people rarely, even though they should, I think people rarely sit down and say, "Oh, that was perfect. Now, what do I learn from it?" You know, they tend to just celebrate and think everything's great. But
that's a good point.
You got to learn from both.
Yes. Well, what were the days, the weeks, the months following all of that like? I mean, what motivated you to get back out there and keep going?
You know, after that, it was kind of the same thing. It was like I didn't, especially for the remainder of that season, I just didn't know what else to do, to be honest. I felt like if I just abandon the rest of the season and go home, that's the worst thing I can do, because then you're sitting there and then it does all, you know, kind of hit you what you just went through. So I think that's an important part and you have to go through that. I just wasn't ready yet. So I went, I finished the season, I won the World Cup, and but the, you know, I would say my big grief came almost a year later, just under a year. I was actually enrolled in school at the University of Calgary, which is obviously where this all happened. But it was also where I was going to train and take some classes the next fall. So when I went up there the next fall, that's when it all hit me, you know, as I was just saying it, if I would have gone home right afterwards, it probably would have happened a lot sooner, but I was up there and, then it all came kind of rushing back, memories that I had of race day, of all of the, even some of the things that I talked to you about today, that I had really just blocked out. I hadn't thought about. And when that happened, that was a tough time for me. It was a difficult time to get through. I was up there. I had some teammates and some friends up there, but no family nearby, trying to study and go to class and train and do all that at the same time, and also dealing with my grief, which came, like I said, maybe 9 months later. But you never know when that's going to hit you. Sometimes it's immediate, sometimes it takes a while.
Mm-hmm. Well, so you did decide to keep going though, and 4 years later found yourself in Albertville in 92, where you finished fourth and 26th. Were you prepared going into that one? How did you kind of handle how it went? Like, were you happy with that or was it a disappointment?
No, that was, to this day, it's almost the most puzzling of all of my games because,
really?
It was going, that the 500 anyway was going awesome. 2 weeks before the games, I set a world record, my first world record. And we were still training pretty heavy. And so we were in Switzerland at the time and then going to Italy to train before the games in Albertville. And so I think as I look back now, it was like, since we were training hard, and I've skated so fast, we thought, well, man, when we rest now, these next couple of weeks, we're going to just fly, you know, because mm-hmm. that's when, you know, your body starts to feel better and better when you get some rest. And
it's the magic, right? But magic feel like, happens.
Yeah, exactly. And so we were kind of at this isolated little place in Italy, with just a track and nothing else. And now we're resting and almost, I think we just over rested. We literally didn't do much at all for 2 to 2.5 weeks. And even though I felt like I was in good form when I got there, I was just flat. I felt great and confident during, even, you know, most of the way through the race, but just flat. And then, you know, two of the guys, it was basically going to be between myself and my friend from Germany for gold. And, he won and then two other guys beat me who had never beaten me before. And that's, you know, that was really, that one for me was tough to handle. 4 years before that, I hate to say it, but the result wasn't, didn't care. Like it wasn't the most important thing that day, you know, and this time it was, and I should have won and I didn't. And when that happened, same kind of schedule. I had 3 days between the 500 and 1,000, and I was so down about it. I literally just checked out. Like I was mentally, physically, I didn't do anything. And then the 1,000 was just like, all right, just all or nothing. And I went out and I was flying early, but I knew I had nothing left. Just died during the race. But, so that games is, you know, remains my most disappointing. It was also, there were issues, like it was outdoors, it was raining, it was terrible conditions, but I, you know, never will use that as an excuse. It is what it is. And I, you know, like I said, 3 guys beat me and congratulations to them. You know, that's how it is.
Well, so going into Lillehammer is your fourth Olympic Games. You were the world record holder mm-hmm. again in the 500 meters, and some people thought you were unbeatable. And I think even you thought, like, this is it. Like, this will end it, right? This will end all the drama. And your young daughter named Jane after your sister, she was even there in the stands watching. Like, take us through that first race in the 500.
So the 500, I guess you put it pretty well, because I was unbeatable. I hadn't lost all year. I don't think I'd been beaten in 2 years in the 500. I had the 5 fastest times ever skated were all mine.
Wow.
And so, yeah, I mean, it was like, just go out there and do your thing. And then finally, this is going to kind of be over or come to a happy ending here. And, you know, it was an interesting time. It was the Nancy and Tanya thing going on. It was,
that's right,
you know, my own saga. I knew, you know, going down the last 100, this has happened again. You know, I didn't fall. People say, oh, you fell again. Well, no, I didn't fall, but I might as well have, you know. So I probably could have skated 85-90% of my best and still won, or I'd certainly been on the podium, but but you don't do that at the Olympics. You go for it. And
right.
And I did. So here I was again, you know, with no medal of any color and one race to go.
I mean, how do you wrap your mind around that? I mean, that just, it's your fourth Olympics, you know, and it just seems like you said, there was a saga, like it was every single time something was happening. Like how, you know, again, you've got 1,000 left. I mean, like, what were you thinking at that point?
So, you know, the worst thing you can do is feel sorry for yourself. And I never did that. I was, of course, I was very disappointed and very confused as to why it didn't happen again. And, but, you know, I think the difference this time, especially from 4 years or 2 years before, I guess, in Albertville, was that this time I knew I was skating just as good as I ever have. It was just, okay, I had one little place where I slipped. Doesn't mean you're not skating well. And I was, you know, I had won a couple World Cups in the 1,000 that season. So, you know, I think people, because the 1,000 wasn't my better race and I didn't win the 500, people pretty much wrote me off. But in my own mind, I at least knew, you know, for me, this isn't over. To this day, if I hadn't won my last race, you know, probably at least media wise would not have considered my career a success, but I didn't think that at all. You know, I knew what I had accomplished on the ice, and I know, and everybody knows, I'm good enough to have a gold medal or two or even four by this point. Mm-hmm. But if I don't, it can't define my life. Like what I learned along the way with my falls, with my dad, mm-hmm. you know, and his lessons and all these things. And it was like, what I want to do is go skate to my potential. And if I do that, then I might win. I might finish fourth. I might, you know, finish 10th, but I'll know if it was my best race. And if I can do that, I'll be very satisfied, and I can leave here knowing that, you know, there's nothing else I could have done, and I'll be able to live my life as an athlete. You kind of, you know, I know you've been through these moments, and you have to ask yourself, you know, if this is okay. Yeah, this is all right. Yeah, it's probably the most important thing in my life right now, mm-hmm. but I have a long life, and is it always going to be the most important thing in my life? I don't know, but I know I've done everything I can to be at my best. And that is truly all you can do. You know, you can only be the best you can be.
Yeah. I think that's super important to recognize that you have to know that for yourself. Like the media can say things, or, you know, if you're on that level, or your competitors are going to say things, coaches, whatever level, whatever the word is, like you have to know in your heart and in your mind what you're capable of and what you've done. And you have to define success for yourself, not based on what other people are saying. And that's, it's really hard to separate that sometimes. I think that's really amazing that you were able to do that in those moments, like right there in the middle of it, you know, in between events even.
I'm glad I was able to do that, but I think a lot of the reason I was able to do it is because of what I had been through, you know, and mm-hmm. because of Jane, because of my falls, because of, you know, the disappointments. You know, almost every other time I'm on the ice, I'm winning or I'm on the podium, and then the Olympics weren't. But that's, you know, I know what people say. I literally saw headlines, you know, 4 days earlier, I was, you know, the biggest choker in, you know, Olympic history. And now I'm this, who knows what, now they want advice on how to handle pressure. I'm like, you're the same guy that just wrote this about me 4 days ago. Why is it different? It's not. I'm the same guy.
Well, now, so back to the 1,000, you're getting ready to start that race. It's your final race after all of this. Like, what, you were in a good headspace to handle everything, but what was going through your mind? Like, did you know that was going to be your very last race? Were you planning on being done good, bad, or indifferent? Were you ready? Like, how did you walk into that?
Yeah, I am. Well, I knew it was my last Olympic race. I had pretty much determined that another 4 years just that wasn't going to happen, even though I still loved what I did. I really still was improving, but 4 years, it's just such a brutal sport physically, let alone the mental side. But I was ready. You know, I had three pretty good days on the ice, and so I still felt good. And mentally, it was, as I said, I was just like, all right, we're going to leave here, you know, skating the best race I can. I wanted to skate to my potential. And so my goal literally wasn't, it had changed, you know, over time from winning Olympic gold to just skating my best at the Olympics. And so that was more the frame of mind I was mm-hmm. in. Quite frankly, I didn't feel very good in warm up for a change that week, but it wasn't nerves. Strangely enough, I had a calmness about me. And I just, you know, even after warm up, because we always skate before 1,000 meters, there's always, or almost always, a 500 meters before it, like an hour or so before. And the Olympics are unique in that it's just that one distance each day. So when I didn't feel good in warm up, I just went on. I wanted to feel like I skated 500. So, you know, before I went to the line, so I got on a stationary bike, hammered really hard to kind of get my legs to hurt a little bit, to feel like I've raced. And then, yeah, so then I went back out for the race, and I did. I felt better. I felt more stable on the ice. I felt my legs felt good. There's just so many things that try to go through your mind, you know, in the last few minutes before.
Oh, yeah.
Before any big race, but certainly before your last mm-hmm. one. And, you know, just trying to keep it all in perspective. And when the gun went off, it was a super feeling, like easy. And 600 meters, I was faster than anybody. It was faster than anybody had ever skated 600 meters. And
did you know you were going that fast?
I knew. I did because, so, you know, your coach tells you your split times, and it's just so loud in there, you can't hear anything, but, you know, they have these little boards with numbers on them, so he puts up the numbers, and so I knew that I was going well, and better yet, I just knew that it came easy, mm-hmm. like it wasn't a struggle. I had 400 meters to go, and I wasn't, you know, just gassed. I was like, all right, I got something left here. And we got to the backstretch with 200 to go. And then it's like, okay, this is good. hang on here. It's probably a medal. I don't even care what color, but it's probably a medal. And then when I crossed the line, I looked up, I saw this WR next to my time.
Oh, wow.
And, we're doing that, you know, that. Then I, like I said before, then I knew, all right, I skated to my potential. Again, if someone beats me, congratulations, but this is all I got.
Walk away, feel good, right?
Yeah, exactly. It was just relief more than anything. And I, at that moment, there were still 30 guys that had to skate, but quite honestly, I knew that, you know, maybe one or two had a chance to skate that time, but I felt like it was probably good enough, but I didn't even care. I just was just so relieved.
Okay, I have to ask, what was it like to finally, after four Olympic Games now and all the drama and all the saga, to finally stand on top of that podium and hear the national anthem play?
Yeah, that was, you know, it's something that, you know, very few can relate to. And, you know, for me, it was just, first of all, it just went too fast. You know, it's like, all right, I just need, I, this song, there's got to be more verses or something to this song. It's like, that's the fastest song I've ever heard. But I just, you know, everything comes to your mind. For me, it was like a lot, certainly about my sister and the family and all that, but also the just kind of thought about the, I don't know, hundreds, I guess, of people that kind of helped along the way from the time I was a kid to helping my mom and dad send us to Europe to train to, you know, all the little things. And the, those, like, they all kind of make up who you are. You know, it's not just a couple different things. It's everything. And to this day, I hear the song and it's, you know, you probably do too. It just has a special.
Yeah.
Special feeling, a special meaning, and
it's never the same again, you know, is it?
It's not. That is by far the most patriotic I've ever felt in my life.
Well, I love it. I was watching some videos the other day just to, you know, kind of remember your story, because I remember watching it as a kid, and just it was so cool then, and I was totally in tears watching it again the other day, and I watched your whole anthem as you saluted your sister from the podium, and then you took a victory lap with your daughter, who is Jane's namesake. Like, it's so complete, and it's so epic and fulfilling in so many ways. Just so special. And I love too that you said, I think you said even your competitors were cheering for you and excited that you were like finally on the podium. I think that says so much.
Yeah, it really is. That's one of the coolest parts. Norwegian guy, before the race came up and said, I hope you win today. And he was good. Like, he was no slouch. And that's, you know, I guess, you know, when you've got the respect of your competitors, and that's, at the end of the day, that's really all you want is their respect, you know. And you know, you're friendly with them over the years, we compete as friends, and once, you know, when the gun goes off, everybody wants to win. But you know, again, years down the road, you look back on the friendships and things more than anything. Mm-hmm.
When you've described an athlete's kind of ultimate purpose with just elegant simplicity, you said, if you use your sport to make you a better person, then you've won. Like, how has your sport made you a better person?
Who you are is kind of determined by how you react to those things that happen along the way. And so because of all the things that happened in my career, the good and the bad, you better take something away from it. And doesn't matter what your sport is, but I think there's hardly a better teacher in life than sports. Mm,
so well said. I love it. Where can we continue to follow you online and continue to just be inspired and encouraged by you, Dan?
So, you know, I'm still doing quite a bit of speaking and so forth, corporate stuff, but maybe more importantly, I still have my foundation, Dan Jansen Foundation, and we are doing a lot of good things for families affected by cancer. You know, when Jane was sick, she had to have her bone marrow transplant in Seattle. And, so we as a family had to travel back and forth. My mom and dad lived out there for almost a year while she was being treated. And it's expensive on the families. And so my foundation, although we do many things and we do scholarships and we do different things, but our biggest fund is the Family Aid Fund. And so we help families with non-medical expenses. So they've had to travel, or they've room and board, or, you know, literally daily, almost daily. We got another one this morning. We get requests, and they might be paying bills that their company is going to shut the power off because they can't afford their gas bill, and because their son or daughter is being treated, and, you know, all their money has gone to this. And so those are some of the things we're doing, and it's been rewarding, but it's been the, you know, a big help to a lot of families in an area that I think people don't realize how important it is. You think about all the medical bills, but there's just bills of life that go along with it.
Oh yeah, that adds up. We'll make sure to put the link in the show notes so people can find it. No problem.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, Dan, thank you so much for coming on the podcast, for teaching us, for inspiring us, and just encouraging us with your incredible story.
Thank you, Laura. All the best to you, and thanks for having me.
It was such an honor to speak with Dan. I just love how he talked about getting to the point before his final race that he was really okay and proud of his career, even if he never stood on the podium. That others could say what they wanted or be disappointed, but in his heart, he knew that he had done his very best. Perhaps initially the gold medal had seemed like the final destination of his life, but along the way, through the loss of his sister and his other Olympic experiences, he learned that there was so much more to life than just a medal. But of course, that doesn't take away from how happy and relieved he was to finally stand on that podium. Even his competitors knew it was his turn. And yeah, that anthem, it's definitely too short. Anyone want to tack on a couple of verses for us? Well, Dan's journey is just so inspiring, and it reminds me of how unique each of our paths really are. Whether you're listening and you're an athlete, an entrepreneur, a parent, student, coach, no matter what your title is, we're all on a journey of discovering what gives us purpose. And for the athletes out there looking to improve their athletic performance with purpose, I'm offering a free live masterclass where I'll teach you how to improve your athletic performance without spending more hours in the gym. If you're ready for change and want the skills to take your performance to the next level, then I want you to go and sign up at laurawilkinson.com/masterclass. That's laurawilkinson.com/masterclass to sign up for my free live masterclass on improving your athletic performance. I'll see you there. Be sure to join us next week as we have MMA fighter Matt Lindland on with us. On behalf of Hope Sports, I'm Laura Wilkinson. Thanks again for tuning in and have a great week. This podcast is produced by Evoterra and Simpler Media. And for more information on Hope Sports and to access the complete archives, please visit hopesports.org.